All right. Thanks, Jenny, for the introduction. And of course, very glad to be speaking here today on one of the topics that, well, I've done a lot of work on over the years, still do a lot of work on, and it's something that I would also say is just a pleasure to work on. It's always a challenge. We always see new things. We always get new insights. So yeah, what I want to focus on today a bit is milk powders, infant formula, current research, current science, what are we doing with it? And I'm particularly focusing on the solubility aspect. And if we're looking at that, and I mean, if we take a step back and we look at powder production and we look a bit at, okay, what did we do in the past? What are we doing at present? What might we be doing in the future? And I think what we typically tend to see in the past, of course, powder production was a lot about removing water, because of course, that's still our main aim, without creating defects. I mean, that was pretty much it. That worked well. But of course, when you start doing these things well, and that always happens, then rather than becoming benefits, they become standards. And of course, everybody takes them as a prerequisite and we move to the next step. And what we see a lot more now, of course, everywhere, it's not just about water removal without creating any defects, but it really becomes as well about efficient water removal. Efficiency is very important these days, of course. And on the other hand, as well, looking at optimizing powder properties. And of course, in that way, a lot of focus on solubility. We don't want to see any visual defects in the powders or after reconstituting. Same about browning, of course. We don't want to see nutritional properties, all that. And I think what we really see at the moment, that's going to continue in the future. It's going to be a lot more about efficiency, but also about powder design for that user experience. That is a key driver. I mean, we only have to look at the infant formula markets in various countries. Take China as an example, of course, where we really see that. Of course, safety is majorly important. Nutrition is majorly important. But that user experience, being able to dissolve a powder easily, no issues, no foam, nothing sticking to the wall. That is really what is a big driver at the moment and will continue to be so. And of course, that's where we always get to the nice interface of the powder. What do we actually want out of it? Whether that's a milk powder, whether that's an infant formula powder. On the one hand, of course, we're looking at what does the user or the consumer want out of it. If we take an infant formula, for instance, and we say, of course, it should provide all that nutrition. It should have excellent physical appearance, easy to handle, easy to dissolve. No issues, no physical defects, but also no off-flavor, off-taste, of course. Which are all fair enough. That's what we would expect, of course, somebody to want. But on the other hand as well, if we're manufacturing powders, yes, we can do all these things. Yes, we can deliver all these things in the powder manufacturing process, but we also really need to make it feasible. So we need to be able to do that at high enough capacity and yield. I mean, we don't want to see any issues during processing. We need to get that shelf life as well. So that's really a matter, of course, of how to balance these two. And that's really, of course, where the big interplay comes in getting a high quality product. We need to look at the physics and at the process, but we also need to look at the efficiency and at the economical aspects of this. So really, it's about combining these two and saying, okay, what do we need to be on top of that game? And that's really about combining product characteristics and drying technology. I mean, from a product perspective, of course, if we want to run a drying process efficiently, if we want to control all these factors, we need to know what is happening to our product during drying. We need to know what are the sensitive ingredients that can start causing issues. Is that proteins? Is that carbohydrates? Is that something else? We need to know what really steers those drying properties. On the other hand, to get to an efficient process as well, we need to focus on the drying technology. So of course, we need to understand our unit operations. We need to understand our heat and mass balances. in the dryer, in the whole process, really. And we need to combine all that knowledge. Once we do that, then it becomes fun. It becomes interesting. You can get very good results, of course. And you can really start getting these high quality powders. And of course, if we're looking at controlling product properties in terms of powders, and whether that's a milk powder or an infant formula, I think we've all seen these graphs before. And there's no need to go through every single bit of it, but really the main thing that we see here, of course, is we have a lot of things that we can control in our process. And that can be preheating, for instance. That can be to what viscosities do we go with evaporation. That can also be our temperatures in the dryer or atomization. And in all cases, they will never, ever just affect one property of a powder. They will always affect multiple properties. So whether that's our moisture content or particle sizes or solubility, or vacuole volumes or any other property. It's really about that combination of things that is happening. And of course, I mean, when we look at this, I mean, these are graphs that we were already drawing 20 years ago, 30 years ago, maybe 40 years ago. So a lot of this is known. And in the same way, we're still having issues, of course. I mean, I don't think anybody can say that they make a powder that never has any issues. There are going to be issues with solubility or with other things from time to time. So it's really a matter of thinking as well, I think. If we say that, of course, we knew all these things already, we're still doing a lot of research, then what did we actually learn? And how are we still progressing? And yeah, what I try to do there is think back. I mean, what did we do in the last 10 years? Of course, there's been an awful lot of work on powders, but what are the main trends? What did we see? What did we learn? On the one hand, I think one of the big things that we've seen is we've seen a lot of new analytical tools being applied to powders in general, but to powder solubility topics as well. We see a lot of different methods for powder solubility that people are proposing in research, that people are exploring in research. Some very simple, some very difficult. But there's an awful lot of work there, and I think it's key to think about, okay, how do we integrate that? On the other hand, I think one of the big things that we see if we look at what is happening, particularly in the academic field, is we see a shift. I mean, comparatively little on milk powders these days, but a lot on infant formula. Whether that's funding driven, whether that's driven by other means, I think a bit of both, but we do see an awful lot of work on infant formula. And more from a powder production perspective, on where do we get some nice insights. Single droplet drying has really been something as well that we've seen in the last 10 years. And we can get some nice insights from that as well. And I'll have one or two examples of that later as well. Because we can learn a lot from it. We just need to be able to translate it then as well into the commercial setting and to see what is happening in the spray dryer. I mean, if we're looking at powder functionality and if we're looking at controlling this from a physical and from a chemical perspective, I think we can distinguish various parts of that. On the one hand, of course, it always starts with ingredients. What ingredients do we use? That can be milk, but of course, when we start looking at infant formula, we have a whole load of other ingredients coming in, and that will already have a very big effect. Of course, we start making a concentrate then. And within that, of course, we need to start thinking already about emulsion properties, about protein interactions, about mineral interactions, particle interactions. This is really that point where we basically design the basis of the powder. I mean, everything that we do there can really help us. Everything that we do wrong at this point already is very hard to undo. Of course, we get into our drying and we get our powder particle properties, which is one thing to consider really. So how are the components distributed in the particle? How do they interact Is my emulsion still stable in the powder particle? But the other thing we really need to consider on top of that really is the powder properties. It's not just about that single particle. It's also really about the structure of that particle, about how it behaves, how it interacts with other particles as well. And you get the topics like solubility, white flags, sediment formation, caking, all that. So it's really when we start looking at that, that's when we really start talking powder functionality. So of course, we need to consider our ingredients. We really need to consider as well, of course, what do we do in that liquid concentrate, in that pre-processing, because that's really our major design stage where we can do things right or we can do things wrong. And then we have to guide that through the dryer and through the drying process really to get to that point. And if we start looking at solubility, solubilization, I think as the main topic for today. I mean, that's also one of these things where we start talking about, we very often and very easily start talking about powder solubility and it's good or it's bad, there might be an issue, there might be no issue. But we need to distinguish them really already, okay, what are we really talking about? When we're talking about solubility, I mean, is that just wettability of powders that we're looking at? Is that dispersibility of powders, which is more at the bulk level? Is that what we're looking at? And I think in most cases, when we're talking about solubility issues of powders, we're actually talking about dispersibility issues of powders. Or is that the final bit really, that solubility, where we really see on a molecular level, all the protein is in solution the way that it should be. All the carbohydrate is in solution. All the fat is the way it should be. So it's really important to distinguish between those and really say, okay, what are we talking about? What are we looking into? So wettability, I mean, as we've all seen before, it's really a method where we typically just put powder on top of water and we see if it sinks. I mean, it works nice. We can get nice insights from it. We see powders that nicely sink through the water and it goes very well. But we also see powders that stay floating on there. And I mean, really, what are the key factors there that we see is particularly surface composition of the powders is extremely important. I mean, do we have protein there? Do we have fat there? Do we have carbohydrate there? I mean, is this powder actually going to go into the... into the water. Density of powder particles can of course be another one there. I mean, if you have a powder particle that doesn't wet too well already, and then we also have a lot of air in the particle, then things are going to be even worse. But that's one of the things that we really need to deal with. Dispersibility, I think we're looking a lot more, we're not just looking at is it sinking through, but how well or how easily can we actually get water to penetrate through a powder mass. Can we get that done quick enough so that we actually get a suspension of powder particles in the water? That can actually later on start dissolving. I mean, if we can't get that, and if we can't get that water to penetrate through a powder mass, that's where we get these lumps. That's where we get parts that will not actually disperse. They can be lumps, they can stick everywhere, of course, and that's that part really where we see need to avoid that. And that's often when we're talking about insolubility, poor solubility, we're actually mainly talking about poor dispersibility. I mean, what are main contributors there? Really, you're very often looking at particle sizes and agglomeration, of course. I mean, very small particles, we typically get issues, very polydispersed particle sizes, so small ones, big ones, everything mixed together. We start getting issues with getting that water in between the powder particles and we get lumping. Agglomeration, of course, that's what really helps there. And that's what we need to keep in mind. If we're looking at solubility, I mean, that is often more a measure of how quickly do components go into solution. But what we typically see as well is that if we can disperse the powder, then it typically will dissolve as well. It may be slow, it may not be as quick as we want it to be, but it will start dissolving. I mean, what do we see there again? I mean, we see things like free fat on the surface of powder particles. That whole component distribution is, of course, not only important for can we get the water between the powder particles and get it to disperse like that, but also can that water actually go into the powder particles and start dissolving the different components. Well, what we typically see is, of course, the carbohydrate is never really a problem. I mean, the lactose from your milk powder or your infant formula, that will dissolve no problem. The salts as well, at least the soluble ones. The issue gets more, of course, into the protein, into the fat. That's where we can get these solubility issues, and we might not be able to get it back into solution. So, I mean, if we're looking at key factors that limit that solubilization, that really give us these issues, I think the two to really look out for there is, on the one hand, what is on the surface of your powder particles. So once we get an unfavorable powder particle surface composition, and particularly free fat, is a key one there, of course, that we need to keep in mind. The other one is aggregation of proteins. I mean, it can happen during the pre-processing in the liquid state, but it can also happen during the drying process. And that aggregation of proteins or of protein-stabilized particles, because I think our emulsions, in most cases, still have a surface with many protein on there. I mean, those are the key drivers, really, for a lot of the issues that we see. So if we start looking at that component distribution first, and that's really looking at, okay, where are the different components that I have in my powder, and particularly how does the surface of that powder particle differ from the rest of that powder particle? And I mean, as an example, some work that we did years ago already, but I think that illustrates it quite nicely. We made a whole series of milk protein concentrates. At the time, different protein contents from about 35% as basis up to 90%. And of course, with increasing protein content, we remove lactose largely. We'll always have a bit of fat in these powders, and we have some ash and some water as well. But really what we did with these is not just look at total composition, but also start looking at surface composition. And what we typically tend to see, so what we did here for four of these MPCs, the 35, the 60, the 80, and the 90, show surface composition on the left each time, bulk composition on the right each time. And what we tend to see, if we look at surface composition for these powders compared to the bulk, we see a lot more protein actually on that powder particle surface, but we also see quite a bit of fat. On a total powder composition, we hardly see any fat. We're looking at less than 1% in these samples. But if we start looking at that surface of these particles, then we can start getting in the range of 10%. So a lot of that fat is actually concentrating on the surface of these particles. And of course, that's going to give a very different behavior than what you would see, for instance, if you had a lot of carbohydrate there, if you had a lot of protein there. So from that perspective, key one to look into. So, and we did some recent studies, some of the work we did at RMIT in the last couple of years, looking for instance as well at milk powders and free fat. So what we simply did is took a whole milk powder and a skim milk powder, stored them at different conditions, and also start really looking at what is happening to that free fat, but also try to visualize that under a confocal microscope. And what you see nicely, I mean, if we look at whole milk powder in the bottom row, I mean, at the start, we see that powder particle with these bright red specks that we see, that's some free fat on the surface. But what we do see, if we start storing that at higher temperatures, at for instance 45 degrees here, and particularly if we start combining that with high humidity as well, I mean, we get more and more and more fat accumulating on that surface. And of course, that's going to have a major impact on solubility and on any other behavior of these powders as well. That same for infant formula, we've looked at that as well and looked there as well in okay, what is that surface composition? How do they behave? And we did that for a series of commercial infant formula products that we took off the shelf. I mean, we measured bulk composition, we measured surface composition, and also there, I mean, on the right-hand side here, the surface fat levels, or surface, yeah, fat in the middle, protein on top, lactose at the bottom. But what you really see there as well is a lot of enrichment with fat. I mean, we get surface fat of up to 70%. So pretty much most of the surface is actually covered by fat, a lot less protein, and very little carbohydrate. One of the things we looked into there at the time as well is, okay, if we look at that surface fat, is that actually the same fat as we see everywhere? Or is there differences? And also there, we could even start picking up some differences in fatty acid composition of the surface fat compared to the bulk fat that of the powder. So an important one to keep in mind, I think. But in general, when we look at fat distribution in these powders, and whether that's a milk powder or an infant formula or any other products, I think what we do tend to see is there's always more fat on the surface in general than there is in the core of the powder. There are different parts, really, or different types of fat that we should really distinguish. I mean, is that an actual layer of free surface fat that we see? Is that some of the emulsion droplets that get very close to the surface? We see a bit of all of it, but particularly, I mean, if we look at images like that and we see these big patches of fat appearing there, I mean, we're not just looking at a bit of surface fat anymore. We really had, or a few emulsion droplets, we really got quite a bit of that destabilization happening at that point. And we can see that as well. I mean, a lot of different measurements that we can do, so more work on milk powder, and typically that overrepresentation there as well. And you can see it very nicely on the electron microscope as well. If you actually take that powder particle before, I mean, you see a nice and smooth surface, but after that fat extraction, you actually see all these areas where fat used to be. You see that as cavities at different openings in these powder particles, really giving that illustration of how much is there, I mean, and how much of the surface it's actually covering. And that has quite a big effect. I mean, one of the things as well, it's not related to solubility, but one of the other topics where we see that quite a lot is fat oxidation. And we know, of course, from an infant formula perspective, particularly, we can have issues with fat oxidation, particularly when we start getting the polyunsaturated fatty acids in there at high levels. We get these issues. And what we really see there is, I mean, if these polyunsaturated fatty acids are nicely encapsulated, are nicely in the form of emulsion droplets that are inside the powder particles, then our risks are relatively low. However, if they are on the surface, if they are destabilized, and if they are basically available as surface fat or free fat, they're easily accessible to oxygen, because no matter how well we do the gas flushing, there will always be a bit of oxygen left, of course, in the cans. And I mean, that is really that fat that will start oxidizing. That is really that part of the fat that will start creating these issues for us. So that's really where we need to look at and see, of course, key factor to get under control, not just from a solubility perspective, where of course there will be big effects as well, but also from that perspective of sensory perception. Of course, I mean, when we start looking at surface fat, and if we can't control that very well, the other thing that we start looking at is issues with powder handling properties, something like flowability. I mean, the more surface fat we get, particularly in whole milk powders, cream powders, of course, as well, is one of these where we get these issues and where we really need to be very careful. But in a cream powder with a fat content that we typically see in there, you can't avoid surface fat. There's always going to be very high levels, but once they're there, I mean, we also run a risk of fat-induced caking, of course, fat-induced stickiness. We get issues with flowability. So it's really looking there as well at powder handling properties, not just solubility. And we've looked at some of these as well. I mean, basically to see if we look at influence of surface fat on powder properties. We put them under a microscope that what we actually see is that microscopy shows fat that's present on the surface. But sometimes that fat actually doesn't give any real reason for instability in terms of caking, clumping. But if we remove the fat, that's what we need to keep in mind as well. If the fat was not there, what else is going to be on the surface? And that's where we can get issues from time to time as well. Because of course, we get a lot of carbohydrate on the surface all of a sudden, or a lot more. So that can cause stickiness as well. So should we avoid all that free fat at all cost? Well, we can't get it to zero anyway in most cases, but I mean, it has some potential benefits as well in terms of stability, but it's really a matter of balancing. How much do we need or want for some stability aspects? How much do we actually want or need or want to avoid for solubility aspects? Where are my thresholds from a flavor perspective? So it's really about controlling that and making sure that we keep getting that, because of course, I mean, if we do have free fat and you see that illustrated in the figure here as well, with increase in free fat, what we typically do tend to get, of course, is poor wetting of powder particles. I mean, all that fat on the surface will be a disaster for getting the powder to wet, because of course, fat and water don't want to mix too well. And based after that, I mean, once we get very poor wettability, dispersibility is going to be a struggle, solubility is going to be a struggle. So we need to be able to control that as well. From that perspective, if we're looking at controlling free fat, how do we keep that under control? How do we make sure, of course, that we keep it to acceptable levels? Then, well, key first and foremost is our emulsion stability. I mean, if we don't go into the dryer with a good emulsion, we're always going to struggle. So we need to make sure that we homogenize properly, we need to make sure that we get small globules, but we also need to make sure that they're covered properly. And that's where we see typically protein-covered emulsion droplets tend to be a lot more stable, tend to be a lot better than emulsifier-covered droplets. I mean, we need to look at the powder matrix as well, powder particle matrix, and we start playing with inlet temperatures. I mean, higher inlet sometimes can reduce free fat. Lower outlet can work as well from time to time to reduce free fat. Lactose crystallization, that's one that we need to avoid at all costs, because what we typically see, of course, once lactose starts crystallizing inside powder particles, we start pushing a lot of fat to the surface. And that's really one of the key things that we see during storage as well. Particularly during storage, lactose crystallization that pushes that free fat to the surface, that damages more of the fat as well. Crystallization of fat is also something to be a bit wary of. It becomes a bit more easy to destabilize once we get that mixture of solid and liquid fat inside, but really lactose crystallization is that key one where a lot of things can start becoming very difficult. Just to illustrate some work that was done a couple of years ago on this really is looking at these effects of outlet temperature in outlet inlet air. That's what we really see. At higher outlet, we tend to see less surface fat. I mean, one of the reasons potentially is that that surface actually sets quicker, it solidifies quicker at a higher temperature there, and it prevents some migration of fat to the interface, because of course we're looking at a powder particle that is drying, that is changing very quickly in there, and at the point where basically most of the water is gone, we don't have too much issues anymore. with these steps in the first stage of the drawing process, where everything is mobile, where everything is highly concentrated, that's where a lot of destabilization can start happening. And that's, of course, as well, that part where we get a lot of these issues with protein aggregation, because, of course, we're looking at proteins, we're looking at high concentrations, we're looking at relatively high temperatures, so we always have that propensity, that risk of protein aggregation happening. And one of the very nice things there, I think, in the last couple of years, and that's something that I referred to earlier, is what can we learn from that as well with techniques like single droplet drying? Because even though, of course, conditions are different than what they would be in a normal spray dryer, I mean, we can get some very nice insights from that. And particularly this paper, it's one from 2015, so already a couple of years old, but in my opinion, it gave some very nice insights. What they did is they compared whey protein isolate and phosphocaseinate, or, well, micellar casein, essentially, during drying, and look basically at what point do the proteins actually start interacting or aggregating in a system like that. And what they basically did is, I mean, they put the micellar casein or native phosphocasein here on the horizontal axis at the bottom, the whey proteins on the vertical axis, but really look at that transition from what we would call a viscous phase, where everything, of course, is highly concentrated, to an elastic phase. Very highly concentrated, but we still have some mobility. And at some point, we start calling it a plastic phase, because essentially, no mobility anymore. And it's really that elastic phase that we see here, highly concentrated, but still a lot of mobility, with everything packed together incredibly closely, of course. That's where a lot of these aggregation reactions, that's where a lot of this instability can start happening. And if we do a comparison like that for micellar casein, at what concentrations does that happen compared to when does it happen for whey protein, then we see huge differences. I mean, in a system like this, whey protein, they see it above about 40% protein. We start getting that transition, we start getting into that danger zone. On the other hand, I mean, for casein, micellar casein in this case, above about 15-16%, we already start getting into that danger zone. I mean, that is really that zone where protein aggregation will happen. And like that, we really need to consider throughout our entire powder particle what is happening, because of course, it's always going to be a combination of a time. How long is something in that zone? What temperatures do we have there? And of course, there's a little temperature gradient, but also what concentrations, because there's a moisture gradient in that powder particle as well. And of course, what we need to think about is how do we translate this from nice lab scale experiments on single droplets to what is happening in an industrial dryer as well, because of course, everything will go a lot quicker there. So what we tend to see is these concentrations at which this danger zone starts to happen, they move quite a bit to higher concentrations when we start putting in a perspective of a dryer, quite simply because a lot of this is happening so much quicker in a spray dryer than it is in a lab scale single droplet drying system. And that's really, of course, when you start looking at these things, start putting them in perspective, it really gets you to think as well, where is this insolubility happening? And an example, I mean, something that we see in milk protein concentrates quite often, particularly in the past, seen it quite often, is we really see that shell of protein forming on the outside of a powder particle. And even after dissolving the powders, trying to dissolve them as well as possible, I mean, yes, you get a crack sometime and everything can dissolve from the inside, but that shell remains And that's really aggregated protein. And where that typically happens is that very early stage in the drying process, concentrations are often relatively high, of course. I mean, our droplet temperature might get a little overshoot, of course, on the surface when it gets into contact with the drying air. And even there we can get, if we have high enough protein, if pH and those things are not very favorable, and combined with just almost an instantaneous hit at a high temperature, that can already cause that formation of a protein shell, a protein case in these powders. In other cases, we actually see maybe that it's not the surface of the powder, but it might actually be core of the powder, because of course that's going to be at a higher moisture content for a longer time. But it's really a matter of looking at your powders, going through the drying process and see what can happen at which stages. So it becomes quite dynamic from that perspective to look at these things. And if we're looking, for instance, insolubility development, in this case, in skim milk powder, a nice example. And it's actually work that was done, I think, already 25 or 30 years ago, but it really illustrates quite nicely. What they did is they took milk concentrates or milk powders, adjusted them all to very different moisture contents. And I mean, that's 3% moisture as a dry powder, of course, but also increased that a bit by slightly moistening it. And on the other hand, as well, concentrates with 40, 50% moisture, these kind of things. Incubate that at different temperatures. And from that, basically look at what is the time needed to start creating instability, insolubility in this case. And what I really saw is, I mean, that insolubility really happens very quickly and very easily if we're in this range between about 10 and 30% moisture. That should actually seem 10 to 30% moisture, not 10 to 30% dry matter. And we're really in that zone there, of course, where we have high temperature, we have high protein, we, because of that, have very high concentration of pH has dropped quite a bit as well, but we still have some mobility. I mean, we're not so dry that nothing is moving anymore. And that is really that zone where we get the risks, where we get the issues with protein aggregation and as a result of that insolubility happening. In skim milk powder, that's mainly protein aggregation, of course. In whole milk powder, but also infant formula, what we see, it's not just purely the protein, but if we have our emulsion droplets there, our fat globules that have protein on the surface, they will just as well or just as easily interact with this. And you can basically take these data, transfer them into models for drying as well, because we're basically looking at kinetics of development of insolubility and what they are really a measure of or a matter of is a temperature, a time that a powder or part of a powder particle really is at certain conditions, combined to what are the concentrations, of course, that we do see at that point. And based on that, you can really start, well, almost modeling insolubility development, various models for that available, you can look at inlet outlet temperatures, how do they affect that solubility? But you see, for instance, as well, powder particle size becomes quite important in there as well, because of course, particle size will determine drying kinetics of your droplet and will thereby determine times and temperatures, how long is something at a certain temperature and will it develop? I mean, a lot of models developed for milk powder like that, but in the same way that can be adapted towards infant formula and things like that as well. So it's really a nice way of applying fundamental research like that for predictive modeling as well. And I mean, just to illustrate, of course, we saw milk powder earlier and we see it quite nicely, but it doesn't just work for milk powder. I mean, we see the milk powder example again on the left. But on the right, for instance, as well, examples of milk protein concentrates. And also there we see that this time that is needed to get very quick instability is very much dependent on moisture content. And again, we see that minimum there, where we actually see that developing. We see quick instability developing. What we do see is for a milk protein concentrate, it actually happens at higher moisture content. I mean, you see the MPC 70 on the left here in the right, or on the right, in the right red triangles, that actually tends to develop that at about 50%, 40, 50% moisture. That is where that critical area is. But if you translate that back and you don't see this is about a dry matter content, but you start relating it to a protein content, that's where we actually start seeing that these things are very similar. They tend to happen at fairly similar protein contents from that perspective. And it's really when we start getting into that zone where the protein gets highly concentrated, proteins start interacting, and we actually need to start, that's when the high temperature can really become a risk factor. And that's really where we can start getting these aggregation reactions that can start giving us issues with insolubility. As I said earlier, it's not just purely protein, but it's also the emulsion droplets that can actually participate in this. So some work that we did a couple of years ago as well is to illustrate this, is showing this insolubility and can we actually induce emulsion instability. Well, what we and one of the things we were looking at the time was basically in relation to flag formation, white flags, white spots in infant formula. What we ended up doing is take an infant formula commercial product that didn't have too many issues. We took the dry powder, started applying different heat treatments to that powder, as we can see on top. And if we heated the dry powder up to about 80, 85 degrees, not a whole lot of issues. If we started going higher, and particularly if we took that dry powder, water activity at the time about 0.2 to 95, and particularly 100 degrees, that's where we started seeing a lot of this instability happening. On the other hand, what we did as well is take that same powder, made it a bit wetter. So we increased water activity to about 0.35, put a small bit more water into it, did the same dry heating essentially afterwards, or the same heating of the powder and reconstituted it. And that's where we saw that even at 65, 70 degrees, if we did that, we could already start causing a lot of instability of emulsion droplets, protein aggregation like that, and a lot of flag formation. I mean, very extreme cases, even with these low temperatures. So from that perspective, really again seeing, it is that part, I mean, these protein aggregation is very dependent on, of course, temperature, but also on water activity. In regions where we're dry enough, where there's very little water, we don't have to worry too much. Actually, in regions where it's wet enough, and we're still talking simply about the liquid, we don't have to worry too much either. We have to go quite intense as well at that point to really start causing stability issues. But it's really that region just before the powder is dry. Bit of water in the system, still some mobility there. And if we start exposing to higher temperatures there, that's really where we get into these risk factors. So that's really to finish off for today, really, as same slide that I showed earlier. If we're looking at controlling these aspects, physical chemistry, or from a physical and chemical perspective, we need to look at all these angles. Of course, powder functionality at the end is crucial. That's what we really look for. But I mean, that already starts at the ingredients. That starts with everything that we do with the concentrate. I mean, that's really our design stage of the product. That's where we need to make sure that we do things well. And of course, then we combine that with the right drying and storage conditions as well to create the right powder particles, to create the right powder properties. And together, that can really give us the powder functionality that we're looking for, that we can play with. And I think, yeah, what I try to do as well at the end is see if we start looking to the future. I mean, what do we see happening? What do we see? What are we going to see? And that was kind of a funny one to do as well, because I could put my academic hat on and look to the future then, and I could look at it from that perspective. I mean, I can also put my industrial hat on and look at the future then and look at it from that perspective. And I think the key thing that I keep coming back to with all these things, it's about balance. Because on the one hand, of course, from an academic perspective, there's so much to do. I mean, there's so many cool things we can do. And there's so many fundamental insights that we can gain, which is great. But on the other hand as well, if we want to make all that work really useful, we have to be able to translate it back to practical control parameters as well. Something that we can do in a process, something that we can actually control. So, and it's really a matter of, yeah, are we getting that balance? Do we have that balance? Sometimes personally feel that we might be going a bit too much on the left-hand side, that the insights and the detail in what we can measure these days, and of course there's so many analytical techniques available, what we can measure there is running so far ahead of the field that we sometimes start lacking the practical application. So I think that is very important. I think the other thing that's very crucial as well, when we look at an area like this, I mean, powders are not new. Drying is not new. Powder solubility issues are not new. They've been there. So it's really needed that we keep building on the past. I mean, there's a great basis of knowledge there, and we should really look at what areas are we missing? What do we really need to add, want to add, rather than say, let's keep reinventing the wheel and keep starting new projects on this all the time. And I think one of the key things really in, yeah, balancing the fundamental insights with the practical control parameters as well is how can we translate a lot of these nice scientific findings to, yeah, the scale of operation and the realistic time scales at which everything is happening. And with that, I'd like to thank you for your attention, of course, and more than happy to answer any questions. So if you have questions, feel free to put them in the chat. And otherwise as well, after the seminar, if you want to have questions left, feel free to reach out by email as well, and I'll try to answer as well as possible as well there. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Tom. What a wealth of knowledge you've got there, and you've done a wonderful job fitting it into 50 minutes. The real advantage, I think, Tom, is having you both as an academic and a person who works in industry, so you get to experience both sides of the equation.
Yeah, it's a fun experience from time to time, I must say. Sometimes I sit at the university as well, and I want to show to some colleagues, please start doing something useful rather than just nice scientific insights. In the same way, looking, yeah, from the other side as well, of course, in the company, saying, oh, please start looking a bit deeper into it as well. So, but yeah, I mean, once you get the best out of both worlds, then you can really, really do an awful lot.
Okay, so could you please read out Patrick's question there?
Yeah. Is the standard insolubility index test too crude a measure to assess differences between powders? Is a less aggressive mixing process more appropriate? And is there such a method in use? Is there a formal test to measure rehydration rates between different powders? Yeah, and I think that is one of these questions indeed that comes back all the time. That, and I think the key thing that we need to do there is distinguish between what do we want to get out of these tests. I mean, if we're looking at let's call it almost standard QA checks, seeing whether powders are behaving as they should, and these kind of things, then I think the standard testing is still very good. I mean, it works. It's been there for a very long time, and we will keep using that for quite some time as well. One of the key things with standard testing is often, should you adjust conditions to be the most realistic, and that's really looking at temperatures as well, for instance, at which you reconstitute. In some cases, I mean, if we're looking at powders for particular cold solubility, then of course we should do it there as well. If we're looking at powders that are always going to be dissolved warm, then we should look at it there as well. If we're looking at, let's see, the more detailed methods, I think they come into play when we start seeing, of course, we want to get that understanding. We want to really figure out what are the differences between powders. We start doing that more, I think, in a research project, in once there's issues, once we want to optimize, and then we can start looking more at, yeah, the different measurements. We can measure a particular rehydration rate. We can measure which of the components is dissolving quickly or slowly. All these things, they tend to come in a lot more, I think, in a research setting than in a standard setting from that perspective. So, I mean, is the insolubility index too crude a measure? I think, yeah, the real answer is it depends on the setting. That for quick insights, it works perfectly fine. But then if we see something in the insolubility index that we don't understand, that we want to understand better, then we need to take that next step and start looking at other methods as well, to see whether they will give us the additional insights of why it is, why the insolubility index might be deviating. And I see another question from Patsy. Is the white flag studied here slow dissolving particles or protein particles? That's another wonderful one. That, I think in the past, I must have worked with probably at least 10 different companies on different white flag issues, and we see something different everywhere. That's one of the, we saw something different everywhere, really, from that perspective. That we've seen white flags that were largely fat, we've seen white flags that were largely protein, we've seen white flags that turned out to be calcium carbonate particles in infant formula that was simply too large and not dissolving properly. But for the flag results that I showed there earlier, they were very rich in fat. That we put them under the confocal microscope as well, did some analytical work on them as well. And they were on a dry matter basis, more than 70% fat. So, and when we looked at those, there were really emulsion droplets that were aggregating. That were aggregated. But yeah, I think one of the key things once you're dealing with white flags, once you're looking at white flag issues, it's really one of these things to say, step one is look at what's really there. Collect some material, and I mean, even with a simple infrared measurement, FTIR, you can already get some very good insights of what it could be, because over the years, we've seen a lot of wild goose chases on white flags where assumptions were made, this has to be protein, this has to be fat or something like that, and you start looking at completely different things. Yeah, the other one is white flags really slow dissolving particles? Yes and no. In some cases, they do show up as slow dissolving particles. That's typically when they're protein rich. If you get that really destabilized fat, then it's never going to dissolve. I mean, once we get these big clumps of fat, it's not going to dissolve. I mean, it's going to stick to the wall. It's going to float as fat ice on top of your of your solutions as well. So if it's anything with white flags, yeah, take that step, analyze, really see what's happening there. That, and I see another question from Johan. For surface free fat increasing during storage, what is the major contribution? Is it the migration of fat from the inner particle or the releasing of globular fat? Also, if replacing part of the lactose with another carbohydrate such as maltodextrin, will it help powder solubility? Start with the first one first, increasing free fat during storage. One of the things we've seen over the years is if we have lactose crystallization happening during storage, we can get some more free fat on the surface. There can be a bit of migration in general, but that's typically very slow. So in most cases, it's really about emulsion droplets becoming destabilized at or close to the surface. Lactose crystallization can be a key one to that. I mean, it really causes physical disruption to that powder matrix. The other thing that we've seen there is that protein aggregation actually keeps continuing in powder particles over time. And it's the protein on the emulsion droplet surface that is aggregating. That can actually cause some coalescence of fat and release of free fat as well. That and then the second part of the question, if replacing lactose with another carbohydrate can help powder solubility. In some cases, yes, in some cases, no. I mean, that in general, lactose is never really the main cause of insolubility. Of course, maltodextrins are very useful when you start looking at caking issues in powders. The other thing that we see with maltodextrins is they're not going to crystallize over time, and particularly once you're looking in the mixed system. So we see in infant formulas quite a bit that we have both maltodextrin and lactose there. That combination, I mean, it's hardly going to crystallize. So from that perspective, it's stable. So, I mean, it can help, but typically only in extreme cases. That where we do get a lot of lactose crystallization happening, that's where maltodextrin can help. Other than that, of course, yeah, it makes your drying process a bit easier from time to time, less issues with fouling, with caking, better glass transition. So it can help a bit from that perspective as well. In terms of protein aggregation, for instance, and that aggregation that can happen during drying, from what I've seen so far, I don't see a major difference between whether maltodextrin is there or whether lactose is there.
Okay, so with that, I'd like to thank everybody for attending. There are no more questions there, Tom. I have included the Menti link for you to provide feedback. We really appreciate all your feedback. So please copy that link. I will also send it with the recording. Tom, thank you so much for all your work you put into today's presentation. Folks, as you know, Tom has given you his email address. So if you have any questions in the coming week, you're welcome to contact him directly.